O thin men of Haddam, why do you imagine golden birds? Do you not see how the blackbird walks around the feet of the women about you?
But let the world dream otherwise. We wear the mask.
And hast thou slain the Jabberwock? Come to my arms, my beamish boy. O frabjous day! Calloo, calay!
To drive free, to love free, to dash reckless and dangerous.
I should have been a pair of ragged claws, scuttling across the floors of silent seas.
Do not go gentle into that good night. Rage, rage against the dying of the light.
Welcome to Poetry Out Loud, the National Recitation Contest, a new program created by the National Endowment for the Arts and the Poetry Foundation. I'm Dana Gioia, chairman of the National Endowment for the Arts. We've put together this special CD for teachers and students to help you master the art of performing poetry. To create this CD, we asked some of America's best writers and actors to recite their favorite poems and to discuss what poetry means to them. You'll hear some of the greatest verse ever written in English. But first, I want to talk to you about how poetry might just change your life. Any sensible person might ask what practical advantage there is to studying poetry. Why would reading and learning to recite poetry help anyone outside of an English class? I'd like to offer you four reasons why poetry, especially the recitation of poetry, might be one of the most practical and important things you learn in school. First, poetry is a powerful way of mastering language. Poetry improves your command of both spoken and written language. It stocks the mind with powerful images and ideas expressed in unforgettable language. Successful people are people who speak well and speak clearly, people who understand both the intellectual and emotional power of language. Second, poetry is a way of training and developing our emotional intelligence. Unlike science or mathematics, poetry reveals how language nearly always communicates feeling, sometimes directly, sometimes indirectly, through images and associations. Third, poetry helps us realize that language is holistic. Poetry demonstrates that how something is said is an essential part of what is actually being said, that literal meaning is only one part of total meaning. The recitation of poetry develops an appreciation that tone of voice, inflection, even rhythm, all carry real meaning. Fourth and finally, poetry helps both to enlarge our humanity and to give us the power to express it. One of the chief uses of poetry, and all literature, is to enlarge our experience, to allow us to see the world through the eyes of other people and other ages. It develops our understanding of important life events like love and desire, birth and death, loneliness and loss. Literature prepares us imaginatively and spiritually for our journey through life, and it helps develop an inner life capable of facing, comprehending, and mastering our external life. Language, perception, communication, compassion, these are the practical gifts that mastering poetry can develop. Poetry was originally a spoken art. It grew out of speech, not writing, and in fact, it developed long before writing was ever invented. Poetry is essentially speech raised to its highest intensity, a way of using words in the most moving and memorable way possible. The Greek poet Homer never wrote down his poems, but performed them aloud, combining memory and improvisation, almost like a rap star. A poem isn't written to be analyzed, but to be experienced, emotionally as well as intellectually. A poem isn't a message in secret code. It is a work of art. Your aim in reciting a poem should be to let people experience it directly, like a movie or a song. Remember, poetry is about pleasure. So here are a few poems for you, simply to enjoy. First is poet Kay Ryan.
Jenny Kissed Me by Lee Hunt. Jenny kissed me when we met, jumping from the chair she sat in. Time, you thief, who love to get sweets into your list, put that in. Say I'm weary, say I'm sad, say that health and wealth have missed me. Say I'm growing old, but add, Jenny kissed me.
Here is poet David Mason.
It seems to me that there's a lot you can do when you're performing poems. There's a lot of range you can have. But you've got to listen to the poem for a while, for a few readings, and decide for yourself if it's a quiet poem, or if it's a boisterous poem, or if it's a fast poem, or if it's a slow poem. And something of that is written into the poem itself. For example, there's a famous poem by William Butler Yeats called The Lake Isle of Innis Free, or Innish Free, as some Irish people say. And it always seemed to me that whatever else you can say about this poem, it's not a loud, boisterous poem. It's probably a quieter poem. So when you try to say it, you might want to say it with some sense of the quietness of the language.
Now the actor Anthony Hopkins reading The Lake Isle of Innisfree.
I will arise and go now and go to Innisfree, and a small cabin build there of clay and bottles made. 9 bean rows will I have there, a hive for the honey bee, and live alone in the bee-loud glade. And I shall have some peace there, for peace comes dropping slow, dropping from the vales of the morning to where the cricket sings. There midnight's all a glimmer, and noon a purple glow, and evening full of the linnet's wings. I will arise and go now, for always night and day I hear lake water lapping with low sounds by the shore. While I stand on the roadway or on the pavement's grey, I hear it in the deep heart's core.
Now Rita Dove recites We Wear the Mask by Paul Laurence Dunbar.
We wear the mask that grins and lies. It hides our cheeks and shades our eyes. This debt we pay to human guile, with torn and bleeding hearts we smile and mouth with myriad subtleties. Why should the world be overwise in counting all our tears and sighs? Nay, let them only see us while we wear the mask. We smile, but O great Christ, our cries to thee from tortured souls arise. We sing, but O, the clay is vile beneath our feet, and long the mile. But let the world dream otherwise. We wear the mask.
Here is a brief but apocalyptic poem by Robert Frost, which was recently voted the most popular poem among high school students, read here by the writer N. Scott Momaday.
Fire and ice. Some say the world will end in fire, some say in ice. From what I've tasted of desire, I hold with those who favor fire. But if I had to perish twice, I think I know enough of hate to say that for destruction, ice is also great and would suffice.
Here's a classic Renaissance love lyric recited by David Mason.
I'm going to read a poem by John Donne. It's called The Good Morrow. It's about waking up with your lover. This is a poem I'm particularly fond of, and I actually used to annoy girlfriends by reciting it to them when I was a young man. Here it is. I wonder by my troth what thou and I did till we loved. Were we not weaned till then, but sucked on country pleasures childishly? Or snorted we in the seven sleepers' den? 'Twas so, but this all pleasure's fancies be. If ever any beauty I did see, which I desired and got, 'twas but a dream of thee. And now, good morrow to our waking souls, which watch not one another out of fear. For love, all love of other sights controls, and makes one little room, and everywhere. Let sea discoverers to new worlds have gone. Let maps to other worlds on worlds have shown. Let us possess one world. Each hath one and is one. My face in thine eye, thine in mine appears, and true plain hearts do in the faces rest. Where can we find two better hemispheres without sharp north, without declining west? Whatever dies was not mixed equally. If our two loves be one, or thou and I love so alike that none do slacken, none can die.
The most important thing to learn when you study poetry is that sound itself is part of sense. Even when a poet deliberately tries to make nonsense, words, images, and rhythms still communicate meaning. In the following poem by Lewis Carroll, odd sounds and invented words create a weird kind of understanding. Here's the actor, David Schwimmer.
Jabberwocky. 'Twas brillig, and the slithy toves did gyre and gimble in the wabe. All mimsy were the borogoves, and the mome raths outgrabe. Beware the Jabberwock, my son, the jaws that bite, the claws that catch. Beware the Jubjub bird, and shun the frumious Bandersnatch. He took his vorpal sword in hand. Long time the manxome foe he sought. So rested he by the tum-tum tree, and stood a while in thought. And as in offish thought he stood, the Jabberwock with eyes of flame came whiffling through the tulgey wood, and burbled as it came. One, two, and through the vorpal blade went snicker-snack. He left it dead, and with its head he went galumphing back. And hast thou slain the Jabberwock? Come to my arms, my beamish boy, O frabjous day, Calloo, Calais, he chortled in his joy. 'Twas brillig, and the slithy toves did gyre and gimble in the wabe. All mimsy were the borogoves, and the mome raths outgrabe.
Poetry is the art most closely related to music. One of the things that poetry does best is to create an emotional mood in the listener. If you ever doubt the importance of learning to recite poetry, think of how often in your own life you want to use words to change someone's mood, to cheer someone who's sad, calm someone who's angry, to take someone who's indifferent and make them like and trust you. In the following poem, E.E. Cummings not only fractures conventional word order, he uses words in unexpected ways. And notice the four-word refrains throughout the poem that operate in a musical way. Here again is David Mason.
Anyone lived in a pretty how town. Anyone lived in a pretty how town, with up so floating many bells down, spring, summer, autumn, winter. He sang his didn't, he danced his did. Women and men, both little and small, cared for anyone, not at all. They sowed their isn't, they reaped their same. Sun, moon, stars, rain. Children guessed, but only a few, and down they forgot as up they grew. Autumn, winter, spring, summer, that no one loved him more by more. When by now and tree by leaf, she laughed his joy, she cried his grief, bird by snow and stir by still, anyone's any was all to her. Some ones married their every ones, laughed their cryings and did their dance, sleep, wake, hope, and then they said their nevers, they slept their dream, stars, rain, sun, moon. and only the snow can begin to explain how children are apt to forget to remember with up so floating many bells down. One day anyone died, I guess, and no one stooped to kiss his face. Busy folk buried them side by side, little by little, and was by was. All by all, and deep by deep, and more by more, they dream their sleep. No one and anyone, earth by April, wish by spirit, and if by yes. Women and men, both dong and ding, summer, autumn, winter, spring, reaped their sowing, and went there came sun, moon, stars, rain.
Gerard Manley Hopkins was one of the most experimental, playful, and difficult poets ever to write in English. Although his poems make profound sense, what attracts you first is the force of their sound. Here again is Kay Ryan.
Pied Beauty by Gerard Manley Hopkins. Glory be to God for dappled things, for skies of couple color as a brinded cow, for rose moles all in stipple upon trout that swim, fresh fire coal, chestnut falls, finches wings, landscape plotted and pieced, fold, fallow, and plow, and all trades, their gear and tackle and trim. All things counter, original, spare, strange. Whatever is fickle, freckled, who knows how, with swift, slow, sweet, sour, adazzle, dim, he fathers forth, whose beauty is past change. Praise him. He has these crazy rhymes. He's just an insane rhymer, and I just get such a kick out of the stuff he puts in here. I love fickle, freckled, all those beautiful things that are stuck together. And look at dappled, stipple, fallow, fickle, freckled. A dazzle. I mean, that's just so funny to me. Partly, he's just so filled with ecstasy. He's so ecstatic that he's laughing. And I think his poems are just laughing. Sometimes they're ecstatic with grief. But that's a kind of a laughter, too. There is a laughter of grief.
Any effective actor or public speaker learns how to infuse language with emotion. The same words, spoken with different emotional tones, have a very different effect on the listener. In learning to recite poetry, you need to choose the emotion or emotions you want to convey. Listen to these three different versions of a few famous lines from William Shakespeare's Hamlet. First, you'll hear actor James Earl Jones, then Michael York, and finally, Mel Gibson.
To be or not to be, that is the question. Whether 'tis nobler in the mind to suffer the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune, or to take arms against a sea of troubles and by opposing end them.
To be or not to be, that is the question. Whether 'tis nobler in the mind to suffer the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune, or to take arms against a sea of troubles and by opposing end them.
To be or not to be, that is the question. Whether 'tis nobler in the mind to suffer the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune, or to take arms against a sea of troubles and by opposing end them.
Notice how different the same words sounded in each version. Actors do the same thing as singers. They color their words with emotion. Sometimes you'll want to color a single line, sometimes the entire poem. The Welsh poet Dylan Thomas often performed his poems in an eerie, rhythmic voice, much different from this dark and persuasive version of Do Not Go Gentle by actor Alfred Molina. This poem is written in a French form called the villanelle, in which two lines are repeated as refrains. Thomas wrote the poem for his father, who was going blind in old age.
Do not go gentle into that good night, by Dylan Thomas. Do not go gentle into that good night. Old age should burn and rave at close of day. Rage, rage against the dying of the light. Though wise men at their end know dark is right, because their words had forked no lightning, they do not go gentle into that good night. Good men, the last wave by, crying how bright their frail deeds might have danced in a green bay, rage, rage against the dying of the light. Wild men who caught and sang the sun in flight, and learned too late, they grieved it on its way, do not go gentle into that good night. Grave men near death, who see with blinding sight, blind eyes could blaze like meteors and be gay. Rage, rage against the dying of the light. And you, my father, there on the sad height, curse, bless me now with your fierce tears, I pray. Do not go gentle into that good night. Rage, rage against the dying of the light.
Here, Angela Lansbury takes a poem that some might consider intellectual. Listen to how she imbues the poem with emotional anxiety and concern.
This is a poem by William Wordsworth. It was the first poem that I ever learned at school. I guess I was about 9 or 10 years old. This was back in England when I was a kid. It's called The World Is Too Much With Us. The world is too much with us, late and soon, getting and spending, we lay waste our powers. Little we see in nature that is ours, we have given our hearts away, a sordid boon. The sea that bears her bosom to the moon, the winds that will be howling at all hours, and are upgathered now like sleeping flowers. For this, for everything, we are out of tune. It moves us not, great God. I'd rather be a pagan suckled in a creed outworn. So might I, standing on this pleasant lea, have glimpses that would make me less forlorn, have sight of Proteus rising from the sea, or hear old Triton blow his wreathed horn.
Anthony Hopkins grew up in Wales, not far from the hometown of Dylan Thomas. Listen to how Hopkins seems to recall his own childhood through Thomas's rhapsodic poem, Fern Hill.
Now, as I was young and easy under the apple boughs about the lilting house, and happy as the grass was green, the night above the dingle starry, time let me hail and climb, golden in the heydays of his eyes, and honoured among wagons I was prince of the apple towns. And once below a time my lordly had the trees and leaves trail with daisies and barley down the rivers of the windfall light. And as I was green and carefree, famous among the barns about the happy yard and singing as the farm was home to the son that is young once only, time let me play and be golden in the mercy of his means. And green and golden I was huntsman and herdsman, the calves sang to my horn, the foxes on the hills barked clear and cold, and the Sabbath rang slowly in the pebbles of the holy streams. All the sun long it was running, it was lovely, the hay fields high as the house, the tunes from the chimneys, it was air and playing lovely and watery, and fire green as grass. And nightly under the simple stars as I rode to sleep, the owls were bearing the farm away. All the moon long I heard, blessed among stables, the nightjars flying with the ricks, and the horses flashing into the dark. And then to awake, and the farm like a wanderer white, with dew come back, the cock on his shoulder. It was all shining, it was Adam and maiden. The sky gathered again, and the sun grew round that very day. And so it must have been after the birth of the simple light, in the first spinning place, the spellbound horses walking warm out of the whinnying green stable onto the fields of praise. and honoured among foxes and pheasants by the gay house under the new May clouds, and happy as the heart was long in the sun, borne over and over I ran my heedless ways. My wishes raced through the house high hay, and nothing I cared at my sky-blue trades that time allows in all his tuneful turning, so few and such morning songs, before the children green and golden follow him out of grace. Nothing I cared in the lamb-white days that time would take me up to the swallow-thronged loft by the shadow of my hand in the moon that is always rising, nor that riding to sleep I should hear him fly with the high fields and awake to the farm forever fled from the childless land. Oh, as I was young and easy in the mercy of his means, time held me green and dying, though I sang in my chains like the sea.
The recitation of poetry and every other kind of public speaking is about conveying meaning. The primary way in which we convey meaning in our spoken language is through stress. By stressing a word, we emphasize its importance. Poetry operates the same way. It arranges stresses in a pattern that we call meter. Meter conveys meaning. Actors and public speakers understand the power of stress. Actors call this punching a word. By changing the stress, you change the meaning. Listen. You gave her flowers? You gave her flowers? You gave her flowers? When you recite a poem, punch the words you want to emphasize the most. Here, N. Scott Momaday recites a sonnet by Percy Bysshe Shelley.
Ozymandias. I met a traveler from an antique land who said, two vast and trunkless legs of stone stand in the desert. Near them, on the sand, half sunk, a shattered visage lies, whose frown and wrinkled lip and sneer of cold command tell that its sculptor well those passions read which yet survive, stamped on these lifeless things. The hand that mocked them and the heart that fed. And on the pedestal these words appear. My name is Ozymandias, King of Kings. Look on my works, ye mighty, and despair. Nothing beside remains. Round the decay of that colossal wreck, boundless and bare, the lone and level sands stretch far away.
How does someone first fall in love with poetry and great language? Kay Ryan remembers her grandmother reciting Longfellow.
I loved my grandmother, my old grandmother, who would recite poetry to me. And she would look me right in the eye. And she had false teeth, and her voice was a little bit floppy, the way old people's mouths get. They get kind of juicy and floppy. And she would say, life is real, life is earnest, and the grave is not its goal. Dust thou art, to dust returnest, was not written of the soul. And I loved that. I didn't really know what it meant, but I thought it was very great. And she was also a very loving grandmother, so I associated her reciting poetry to me with being loving. The only reason poems last is because they are so amusing and so effective. They last in us. They're the best language. So they stay in us because they are the most beautiful and useful language. So that by learning poems, you really are keeping the very best of English speech or English expression. And you have it to pull out when you need it. Like, let's say your best friend gets in a big car crash and is really badly hurt. You don't think of a novel. You think of a little snatch of a poem that you learned. You always pull poetry out when it's really desperate. Poetry is for desperate occasions. It works in those occasions. It's sufficient to a desperate occasion.
Here again is David Schwimmer.
I think it was watching some Shakespeare plays and then being able to try to speak the words and try to get the rhythms that I realized how powerful and how sharp great words can be, how funny they could be, and also how dangerous they could be. In Shakespeare, you can melt someone's heart with words, or you can, they can be very violent as well and be used as a weapon. And I think that was the first time in performing Shakespeare that I really had a full appreciation of poetry.
Here is N. Scott Momaday.
I grew up in a very creative household. My mother was a writer, and she was always reading aloud to me, so I heard poetry when I was very small. My father was a painter, an Indian, a full-blood Kiowa, and he used to tell me stories from Kiowa oral tradition, and I used to hear him speak in Kiowa, even though I didn't understand it. I was very impressionable, and those things stayed with me. They have stayed with me throughout my life, those early sounds of Kiowa and of the music of poetry.
Here again is David Mason.
Poetry first attracted me as a boy because my parents read it aloud to me, and I've always thought of it as an oral art more than a visual one. Some surface charm or intriguing sound has to be present for poems to lure me, and I've always been fond of getting them by heart so I can carry them around in my head without a book. For one thing, I've often found myself alone, either hiking great distances or working out of doors, and have been glad to have poems and songs by heart so I could entertain myself. I always like reciting them to my friends and family when occasion allows. Poems can dignify small moments in our lives, turning them into ceremonies of awareness. Ultimately, that's what poetry's about for me. It's a kind of verbal awareness of being alive in the world.
One of the basic questions in reciting poetry is how to deal with the line breaks. Should you stop? Should you pause? Should you just run on without regarding them? These questions become especially tricky when the lines rhyme. There is no one answer. Different people choose different solutions. But here's a little advice. First, let the sense of the poem guide your reading. If the line ends in a period or a comma, then stop or pause as you would in prose. If the sense of the line continues unbroken into the next line, then don't pause at all, or at least don't pause for more than a split second. Most traditional rhymed poems will require, or at least permit, a small pause at the end of the line. But you have a great deal of freedom in choosing how long to make it. Here are a few poems written in traditional rhyme and meter. Notice how the speakers handle the line endings. First, the playwright David Henry Hwang reciting "Hope is the Thing with Feathers" by Emily Dickinson.
Hope is the thing with feathers that perches in the soul and sings the tune without the words and never stops at all. And sweetest in the gale is heard, and sore must be the storm that could abash the little bird that kept so many warm. I've heard it in the chillest land and on the strangest sea, yet never in extremity it asked a crumb of me.
Now the poet Diane Teal.
This Yeats poem, When You Are Old, is an old favorite of mine because of the way it imagines the future. I remember when I first read this poem, the line, "One man loved the pilgrim soul in you," I felt as if the poem was written directly for me. And I think that's one of the experiences that I really love about poetry, how we can read certain lines and feel as if the poet was looking right into our lives. William Butler Yeats. When you are old. When you are old and gray and full of sleep and nodding by the fire, take down this book and slowly read and dream of the soft look your eyes had once and of their shadows deep. How many loved your moments of glad grace and loved your beauty with love false or true? But one man loved the pilgrim soul in you, and loved the sorrows of your changing face. And bending down beside the glowing bars, murmur a little sadly how love fled, and paced upon the mountains overhead, and hid his face amid a crowd of stars.
There's a metaphor we often use when talking about memorization. We say to know something by heart. It means to know something so well that you bring it into the center of yourself. The best way of reciting a poem is to know it by heart. And here's a poem I've known by heart for decades. It's called The Road Not Taken by Robert Frost. Two roads diverged in a yellow wood, and sorry I could not travel both and be one traveler. Long I stood and looked down one as far as I could, to where it bent in the undergrowth. Then took the other, as just as fair, and having perhaps the better claim, because it was grassy and wanted wear. Though as for that, the passing there had warned them really about the same. And both that morning equally lay in leaves no step had trodden black. Oh, I kept the first for another day. Yet knowing how way leads on to way, I doubted if I should ever come back. I shall be telling this with a sigh. Somewhere, ages and ages hence, two roads diverged in a wood, and I took the one less traveled by, and that has made all the difference. Although the sonnet was invented in Renaissance Italy, over the past 500 years it has become the most popular form of English language poetry. A sonnet consists of 14 lines of rhymed iambic pentameter, but the reason it is popular is that poets discovered right away that it was the perfect vessel to express intense emotion, especially about love and romance and all the problems that they bring. The most famous writer of sonnets in English is William Shakespeare. Here is James Earl Jones reading Shakespeare's sonnet number 55.
Not marble nor the gilded monuments of princes shall outlive this powerful rhyme, but you shall shine more bright in these contents than unswept stone besmeared with sluttish time. When wasteful war shall statues overturn, and broils root out the work of masonry, nor Mars his sword nor war's quick fire shall burn the living record of your memory. Gainst death in all oblivious enmity shall you pace forth. Your praise shall still find room, even in the eyes of all posterity that wear this world out to the ending doom. So, till the judgment that yourself arise, you live in this, and dwell in lovers' eyes.
Although the romantic poet John Keats was born two centuries after Shakespeare, he passionately admired Shakespeare. That may be one reason why he wrote so many sonnets of his own. Here is Rita Dove reciting When I Have Fears That I May Cease to Be by John Keats.
When I have fears that I may cease to be, before my pen has gleaned my teeming brain, before high-piled books and charactery hold like rich garners the full ripened grain, when I behold upon the night's starred face huge cloudy symbols of a high romance, and think that I may never live to trace their shadows with the magic hand of chance, and when I feel, fair creature of an hour, that I shall never look upon thee more, never have relish in the fairy power of unreflecting love, then on the shore of the wide world I stand alone and think till love and fame to nothingness do sink.
And now the actress Alyssa Milano recites two classic American sonnets. The first is by Anne Bradstreet, America's first published poet. In this poem, Bradstreet celebrates her love for her husband.
To my dear and loving husband, if ever two were one, then surely we. If ever man were loved by wife, then thee. If ever wife was happy in a man, compare with me, ye woman, if you can. I prize thy love more than whole mines of gold, or all the riches that the East doth hold. My love is such that rivers cannot quench, nor aught but love from thee give recompense. Thy love is such I can no way repay. The heavens reward thee manifold, I pray. Then while we live in love, let so persevere that when we live no more, we may live ever.
And now Alyssa Milano reads a very different sort of love poem. I Think I Should Have Loved You Presently by Edna St. Vincent Millay, a poem about a love affair coming to an end.
I think I should have loved you presently, and given in earnest words I flung in jest, and lifted honest eyes for you to see, and caught your hand against my cheek and breast, and all my pretty follies flung aside that won you to me, and beneath your gaze, naked of reticence and shorn of pride, spread like a chart my little wicked ways. I that had been to you had you remained, but one more waking from a recurrent dream, cherish no less the certain stakes I gained, and walk your memory's halls, austere, supreme, a ghost in marble of a girl you knew, who would have loved you in a day or two.
Free verse doesn't have the regular beat of metrical poetry, but that doesn't mean that you should read it aloud like prose. You simply have more freedom to pick the words and phrases you want to emphasize. Now, Candy Alexander recites Harlem, Dream Deferred by Langston Hughes.
What happens to a dream deferred? Does it dry up like a raisin in the sun? Or fester like a sore and then run? Does it stink like rotten meat? Or crust and sugar over like a syrupy sweet? Maybe it just sags like a heavy load. Or does it explode?
When you talk about free verse, the conversation inevitably comes around to Walt Whitman. His long, rhapsodic lines have no specific meter, but they are full of rhythmic energy. Here, writer Richard Rodriguez recites a classic poem by Walt Whitman.
I hear America singing. I hear America singing the varied carols I hear, those of mechanics, each one singing his as it should be, blithe and strong. The carpenter singing his as he measures his plank or beam. The mason singing his as he makes ready for work or leaves off work. The boatman singing what belongs to him and his boat. The deckhand singing on the steamboat deck. The shoemaker singing as he sits on his bench. The hatter singing as he stands. The woodcutter's song. The plowboy's on his way in the morning, or at noon intermission, or at sundown. The delicious singing of the mother, or of the young wife at work, or of the girl sewing or washing, each singing what belongs to him or her and to none else. The day what belongs to the day. At night, the party of young fellows, robust, friendly, singing with open mouths their strong, melodious songs.
Most poems tell stories. Even when a poem is made up just of images, those images tend to be arranged in a way that creates a narrative of emotions. In reciting a narrative poem, your purpose is to make the listener pay attention to the human drama being presented, to feel the events in emotional terms, and to understand their personal importance to the characters. That means that you need somehow to put that drama and those emotions into the words you're speaking. Listen, for example, to the actress Candy Alexander read the opening of Edgar Allan Poe's Annabel Lee. Notice how she suffuses the opening lines with joy so that you feel the sadness of the ending later on more powerfully.
It was many and many a year ago, in a kingdom by the sea, that a maiden there lived, whom you may know, by the name of Annabel Lee. And this maiden, she lived with no other thought than to love and be loved by me. I was a child, and she was a child, in this kingdom by the sea. But we loved with a love that was more than love, I and my Annabel Lee, with a love that the winged seraphs of heaven coveted her and me.
Now listen to a few lines from the end of the poem. Can you feel how she has shifted the emotion?
But our love, it was stronger by far than the love of those who were older than we, of many far wiser than we. And neither the angels in heaven above, nor the demons down under the sea, can ever dissever my soul from the soul of the beautiful Annabel Lee. For the moon never beams without bringing me dreams of the beautiful Annabel Lee. And the stars never rise, but I feel the bright eyes of the beautiful Annabel Lee.
Sometimes a story is as much about the speaker as the person being described. In W.H. Auden's satiric poem, The Unknown Citizen, the bureaucratic speaker is as important as the anonymous citizen being described. Listen to Alfred Molina capture both sides of this story.
The Unknown Citizen by W.H. Auden to JS/07/M/378, this marble monument is erected by the state. He was found by the Bureau of Statistics to be one against whom there was no official complaint, and all the reports on his conduct agree that in the modern sense of an old-fashioned word, he was a saint, for in everything he did he served the greater community. Except for the war, till the day he retired, he worked in a factory and never got fired, but satisfied his employers, Fudge Motors Inc. Yet he wasn't a scab or odd in his views, for his union reports that he paid his dues. Our report on the union shows it was sound, and our social psychology workers found that he was popular with his mates and liked to drink. The press are convinced that he bought a paper every day and that his reactions to advertisements were normal in every way. Policies taken out in his name prove that he was fully insured, and his health card shows he was once in hospital but left it cured. Both producers' research and high-grade living declare he was fully sensible to the advantages of the installment plan and had everything necessary to the modern man, a phonograph, a radio, a car, and a Frigidaire. Our researchers into public opinion are content that he held the proper opinions for the time of the year. When there was peace, he was for peace. When there was war, he went. He was married and added 5 children to the population, which our eugenist says was the right number for a parent of his generation, and our teachers report that he never interfered with their education. Was he free? Was he happy? The question is absurd. Had anything been wrong, we should certainly have heard.
Sometimes the emotions in a story are very complex. In Edwin Arlington Robinson's poem Minerva Chivi, for example, the poem tells a story that is simultaneously very sad and very funny. It's the story of an alcoholic who is at odds with his own life, caught in a kind of web of bitter disillusionment. Listen to how well David Mason brings all of those emotions across in a reading that is both funny and sad.
Minerva Chivi. Minerva Chivi, child of scorn, grew lean while he assailed the seasons. He wept that he was ever born, and he had reasons. Minerva loved the days of old, when swords were bright and steeds were prancing. The vision of a warrior bold would set him dancing. Minerva sighed for what was not, and dreamed and rested from his labors. He dreamed of Thebes and Camelot and Priam's neighbors. Minerva mourned the ripe renown that made so many a name so fragrant. He mourned romance, now on the town, and art, a vagrant. Minerva loved the Medici, albeit he had never seen one. He would have sinned incessantly, could he have been one. Minerva cursed the commonplace and eyed a khaki suit with loathing. He missed the medieval grace of iron clothing. Miniver scorned the gold he sought, but sore annoyed was he without it. Miniver thought and thought and thought and thought about it. Miniver Cheevy, born too late, scratched his head and kept on thinking. Miniver coughed and called it fate and kept on drinking.
We'll end by giving you five great poems recited by five great performers. First, Alfred Molina reading a chilling dramatic monologue by Robert Browning. The speaker of the poem is a Renaissance Italian duke. While entertaining visitors, the duke shows one guest a portrait of his late wife, revealing a mysterious and ominous past.
My Last Duchess by Robert Browning. That's my last duchess painted on the wall, looking as if she were alive. I call that piece a wonder now. Fra Pandolf's hands worked busily a day, and there she stands. Will it please you sit and look at her? I said Fra Pandolf by design, for never read strangers like you that pictured countenance, the depth and passion of its earnest glance. But to myself they turned, since none puts by the curtain I have drawn for you but I, and seemed as they would ask me, if they durst, how such a glance came there. So, not the first are you to turn and ask thus. Sir, 'twas not her husband's presence only called that spot of joy into the Duchess' cheek. Perhaps Fra Pandolf chanced to say, her mantle laps over my lady's wrist too much, or paint must never hope to reproduce the faint half-flush that dies along her throat. Such stuff was courtesy, she thought, and cause enough for calling up that spot of joy. She had a heart, how shall I say, too soon made glad, too easily impressed. She liked whate'er she looked on, and her looks went everywhere. Sir, 'twas all one. My favour at her breast, the dropping of the daylight in the west, the bough of cherries some officious fool broke in the orchard for her, the white mule she rode with round the terrace, all and each would draw from her alike the approving speech, or blush at least. She thanked men, good, but thanked somehow, I know not how, as if she ranked my gift of a 900 years old name with anybody's gift. Who'd stoop to blame this sort of trifling? Even had you skill in speech, which I have not, to make your will quite clear to such a one, and say, just this or that in you disgusts me. Here you miss, or there exceed the mark. And if she let herself be lessened so, nor plainly set her wits to yours, forsooth, and made excuse, e'en then would be some stooping. And I choose never to stoop. Oh, sir, she smiled, no doubt, whene'er I passed her. But who passed without much the same smile? This grew. I gave commands. Then all smiles stopped together. There she stands, as if alive. Will it please you rise? We'll meet the company below, then. I repeat, the Count, your master's known munificence, is ample warrant that no just pretense of mine for dowry will be disallowed, though his fair daughter's self, as I avowed at starting, is my object. Nay, we'll go together down, sir. Notice Neptune, though, taming a seahorse, thought a rarity, which Klaus of Innsbruck cast in bronze for me.
And now Angela Lansbury recites a poem by Matthew Arnold.
Dover Beach. The sea is calm tonight, the tide is full, the moon lies fair upon the straits. On the French coast the light gleams and is gone. The cliffs of England stand, glimmering and vast out in the tranquil bay. Come to the window, sweet is the night air. only from the long line of spray where the ebb meets the moon-blanched sand. Listen, you hear the grating roar of pebbles which the waves suck back and fling at their return up the high strand. Begin and cease and then begin again with tremulous cadence slow and bring the eternal note of sadness in. Sophocles long ago heard it on the Aegean, and it brought into his mind the turbid ebb and flow of human misery. We find also in the sound a thought, hearing it by this distant northern sea. The sea of faith was once too at the full, and round earth's shore lay like the folds of a bright girdle furled. But now I only hear its melancholy, long withdrawing roar, retreating to the breath of the night wind down the vast edges drear and naked shingles of the world. Ah, love, let us be true to one another, for the world, which seems to lie before us like a land of dreams, so various, so beautiful, so new, hath really neither joy nor love nor light, nor certitude nor peace nor help for pain. And we are here as on a darkling plain, swept with confused alarms of struggle and flight, where ignorant armies clash by night.
Now, N. Scott Momaday recites 13 Ways of Looking at a Blackbird by Wallace Stevens.
1. Among 20 snowy mountains, the only moving thing was the eye of the blackbird. 2. I was of three minds, like a tree in which there are three blackbirds. 3. The blackbird whirled in the autumn winds. It was a small part of the pantomime. 4. A man and a woman are one. A man and a woman and a blackbird are one. 5. I do not know which to prefer, the beauty of inflections or the beauty of innuendos, the blackbird whistling or just after. 6. Icicles filled the long window with barbaric glass. The shadow of the blackbird crossed it to and fro. The mood traced in the shadow an indecipherable cause. 7. O thin men of Haddam, why do you imagine golden birds? Do you not see how the blackbird walks around the feet of the women about you? 8. I know noble accents and lucid, inescapable rhymes, but I know, too, that the blackbird is involved in what I know. 9. When the blackbird flew out of sight, it marked the edge of one of many circles. 10. At the sight of the blackbirds flying in a green light, even the bawds of euphony would cry out sharply. 11. He rode over Connecticut in a glass coach. Once a fear pierced him. In that he mistook the shadow of his equipage for blackbirds. 12. The river is moving. The blackbird must be flying. 13. It was evening all afternoon. It was snowing, and it was going to snow. The blackbird sat in the cedar limbs.
Here again is Kay Ryan.
I Heard a Fly Buzz When I Died by Emily Dickinson. I heard a fly buzz when I died. The stillness round my form was like the stillness in the air between the heaves of storm. The eyes beside had wrung them dry, and breaths were gathering sure for that last onset, when the king be witnessed in his power. I willed my keepsakes, signed away what portion of me I could make assignable, and then there interposed a fly with blue, uncertain, stumbling buzz between the light and me. And then the windows failed, and then I could not see to see.
And now we conclude with Anthony Hopkins reciting The Love Song of J. Alfred Prufrock by T.S. Eliot.
Let us go then, you and I, when the evening is spread out against the sky like a patient etherized upon a table. Let us go through certain half-deserted streets, the muttering retreats of restless nights in one-night cheap hotels and sawdust restaurants with oyster shells, streets that follow like a tedious argument of insidious intent to lead you to an overwhelming question. Oh, do not ask, what is it? Let us go and make our visit. In the room the women come and go, talking of Michelangelo. The yellow fog that rubs its back upon the window panes, the yellow smoke that rubs its muzzle on the window panes, licked its tongue into the corners of the evening, lingered upon the pools that stand in drains, let fall upon its back the soot that falls from chimneys, slipped by the terrace, made a sudden leap, and seeing that it was a soft October night, curled once about the house and fell asleep. And indeed there will be time for the yellow smoke that slides along the street, rubbing its back upon the window panes. There will be time to prepare a face to meet the faces that you meet. There will be time to murder and create, and time for all the works and days of hands that lift and drop a question on your plate. Time for you and time for me, and time yet for 100 indecisions and for 100 visions and revisions before the taking of a toast and tea. In the room the women come and go, talking of Michelangelo. And indeed there will be time to wonder, do I dare, and do I dare? Time to turn back and descend the stair with a bald spot in the middle of my hair. They will say, how his hair is growing thin. My morning coat, my collar mounting firmly to the chin, my necktie rich and modest, but asserted by a simple pin. They will say, but how his arms and legs are thin. Do I dare disturb the universe? In a minute there is time for decisions and revisions, which a minute will reverse. For I have known them all already, known them all. Have known the evenings, mornings, afternoons. I have measured out my life with coffee spoons. I know the voice is dying with a dying fall beneath the music from a farther room. So how should I presume? And I have known the eyes already, known them all. The eyes that fix you in a formulated phrase. And when I am formulated, sprawling on a pin, when I am pinned and wriggling on the wall, then how should I begin to spit out all the butt-ends of my days and ways? And how should I presume? And I have known the arms already, known them all, arms that are braceleted and white and bare, but in the lamplight downed with light brown hair. Is it perfume from a dress that makes me so digress? Arms that lie along a table or wrap about a shawl. And should I then presume? And how should I begin? Shall I say I have gone at dusk through narrow streets and watched the smoke that rises from the pipes of lonely men in shirt sleeves leaning out of windows? I should have been a pair of ragged claws scuttling across the floors of silent seas. And the afternoon, the evening sleep so peacefully, smoothed by long fingers, asleep, tired, or it malingers, stretched on the floor here beside you and me. Should I, after tea and cakes and ices, have the strength to force the moment to its crisis? But though I have wept and fasted, wept and prayed, though I have seen my head grown slightly bald, brought in upon a platter, I am no prophet, and here's no great matter. I have seen the moment of my greatness flicker, and I have seen the eternal footman hold my coat and snicker. And in short, I was afraid. And would it have been worth it after all, after the cups, the marmalade, the tea, among the porcelain, among some talk of you and me? Would it have been worthwhile to have bitten off the matter with a smile, to have squeezed the universe into a ball, to roll it towards some overwhelming question, to say, I am Lazarus, come from the dead, come back to tell you all, I shall tell you all. If one, settling a pillow by her head, should say, that is not what I meant at all. That is not it at all. And would it have been worth it, after all? Would it have been worthwhile, after the sunsets and the dooryards and the sprinkled streets, after the novels, after the teacups, after the skirts that trail along the floor, and this and so much more? It is impossible to say just what I mean, but as if a magic lantern threw the nerves and patterns on a screen, would it have been worthwhile if one, settling a pillow or throwing off a shawl, and turning toward the window, should say, that is not it at all. That is not what I meant at all. No, I am not Prince Hamlet, nor was meant to be. I'm an attendant lord, one that will do to swell a progress, start a scene or two, advise the prince, no doubt an easy tool, deferential, glad to be of use, politic, cautious and meticulous, full of high sentence, but a bit obtuse. At times, indeed, almost ridiculous. Almost at times the fool. I grow old. I grow old. I shall wear the bottoms of my trousers rolled. Shall I part my hair behind? Do I dare to eat a peach? I shall wear white flannel trousers and walk upon the beach. I have heard the mermaids singing each to each. I do not think that they will sing to me. I have seen them riding seaward on the waves, combing the white hair of the waves blown back when the wind blows the water white and black. We have lingered in the chambers of the sea, by sea girls wreathed with seaweed red and brown, till human voices wake us and we drown.
CD was created by the National Endowment for the Arts in partnership with the Poetry Foundation. It was produced and recorded by Dan Stone. I'm Dana Gioia.